Gregory, on my word, we'll not carry coals.
No, for then we should be colliers.
I mean, and we be colier, we'll draw.
Hey, while you live, draw your neck out of color.
I strike quickly, being moved.
But thou art not quickly moved to strike.
A dog of the house of the Montague moved me.
To make is to stir, and to be villain is to stand. Therefore, if thou art moved, thou runst away.
A dog of that house shall move me to stand. I will take the wall of any man or maid of the Montagues.
That shows thee a weak slave, for the weakest goes to the wall.
'Tis true, and therefore women, being the weaker vessels, are ever thrust to the wall. Therefore, I will push Montague's men from the wall, and thrust his maids to the wall.
The quarrel is between our masters and us, their men.
'Tis all one. I will show myself a tyrant. When I fought with the men, I will be civil with the maids. I will cut off their heads.
The heads of the maids?
Aye, the heads of the maids and their maiden heads. Take it in what sense thou wilt.
They must take it in since that feel it.
Me they shall feel while I am able to stand, and 'tis known I'm a pretty piece of flesh.
'Tis well thou art not fish, if thou hast been poor John. Draw thy tool. Here comes two of the house of Montagues.
My naked weapon is out. Quarrel, I will back thee.
How? Turn thy back and run.
Fear me not.
No, Mary, I fear thee.
Let's take the law of our sides. Let them begin.
I will frown as I pass by, and let them take as they list.
Nay, as they dare, I will bite my thumb at them, which is disgrace to them if they bear it.
Do you bite your thumb at us, sir?
I do bite my thumb, sir.
Do you bite your thumb at us, sir?
It's of all of our side if I say I.
No.
No, sir, I do not bite my thumb at you, sir, but I bite my thumb, sir.
You quarrel, sir.
Quarrel, sir. No, sir.
But if you do, sir, I am for you. I serve as good as a man as you.
No better.
Well, sir?
Say. Say, better, here comes one of my master's kinsmen.
Yes, better, sir.
You lie.
Draw, if you be men. Gregory, remember thy swashing blow.
Hard fools, put up your swords. You know not what you do.
What art thou, drawn among these heartless hinds? Turn thee, Benvolio, look upon thy death.
I do but keep peace, put up thy sword. Or manage to part these men with me.
What drawn and talk of peace? I hate the word as the heck. All Montagues indeed have thee coward.
Clubs, bills, and partisans, strike, beat them down. Down with the Capulets, down with the Montagues.
Oh no.
What noise is this? Give me my longsword. Ho!
A crutch. Watchful for a sword.
My sword, I say. Oh, Montague has come and flourishes his blade in spite of me.
Thou villain Capulet, hold me not. Let me go.
Thou shalt not stir one foot to seek a foe.
Thou villain Cap... What?
Oh. Thou shalt not stir one foot to seek a foe. Oh.
Rebellious subjects, enemies to peace, profiteers of his neighbor stand still. Will they not hear? What ho, you men, you beasts, that quench the fire of pernicious rage, with purple fountains issuing from your veins. On pain of torture, from those bloody hands, throw your mistempered weapons to the ground and hear the sentence of your moved prince. Three civil brawls read on an airy word by thee, old Capulet and Montague, have thrice disturbed the quiet of our streets and made Verona's ancient citizens cast by their grave distinguishing ornaments. To wield old partisans in hands old, cankered with peace, to part your cankered hate, if you ever disturb our streets again, your lives shall pay the forfeit of the peace. For this time, all the rest depart. You, Capulet, shall go along with me, and Montague, come you this afternoon to know our farther pleasure in this case. To old Freetown, our common judgment place, once more, on pain of death, all men depart.
Who set this ancient quarrel new approach? Speak, nephew, were you by it when it began?
Here were the servants of your adversary and yours, close fighting ere I did approach. I drew to part them, and the instant came, the fiery Tybalt with his sword prepared. which, as he breathed the finest to my ears, he swung about his head and cut the wind. Who, nothing hurt withal, his timid scorn, while we were interchanging thrusted blows, came more and more, and fought on part and part, till the prince came and parted even apart.
Oh, where is Romeo? Saw you him today? Oh. Right glad I am he was not at this fray.
Madam, an hour before the worship sun, peered forth the golden window of the east, a troubled mind drave me to walk aboard, abroad, where underneath the grove of sycamore, the westward Brutus from the city side. So early walking did I see your son. Towards him I made, but he was ware of me, and stole into the covert of the wood. I, measuring his affections by my own, which then most sought where most might not be found, being one too many but by my weary self, pursued my humor, not pursuing his, and gladly shunned who gladly fled from me.
Many a morning hath he there been seen, with tears augmenting the fresh morning dew, adding to clouds more clouds with his deep sighs, but all so soon as the all-cheering sun should in the farthest east begin to draw the shady curtains from Aurora's bed, away from light stills home my heavy son, and private in his chamber pans himself, shuts his windows, locks fair daylight out, and makes himself an artificial night. Black and portentous must this humor prove, unless good counsel may the cause remove.
My noble uncle, do you know the cause?
I neither know it, nor can learn of him.
Have you importuned him by any means?
Both by myself and many other friends, but he, his own affection counselor, is to himself I will not say how true, but to himself so secret and so close, so far from sounding and discovery, as is the bud bit with envious worm, ere he spread his sweet leaves in the air, or dedicate his beauty to the sun. Could we but learn from whence his sorrow grows, we would as willingly give cure as help.
See where he comes, so please you step aside. I'll know his grievance, or be much denied.
I, when thou wert so happy, by thy stay, to hear true shift. Come, madam, let's away.
Good morrow, cousin.
Is the day so young?
But new should nine.
Ay me, sad hours seem long. Was that my father that went hence so fast?
It was. What sadness lengthens Romeo's hours?
Not having that which makes them short.
In love?
Out.
Of love?
Out of her favor where I am in love.
Alas, that love, so gentle in its youth, should be so tyrannous and rough in proof?
Alas, that love, whose view is muffled still, should without eyes see pathways to his will. Where shall we dine? Oh me, what fray was here? Yet tell me not, for I have heard it all. Here's much to do with hate, but more with love. Why then, oh brawling love, oh loving hate, oh anything of nothing first created, oh heaven, oh heavy lightness, serious vanity, mishapping chaos of well-seeming forms, feather of lead, bright smoke, cold fire, sick health, still waking sleep, that is not what it is. This love feel I, that feel no love in this, dost thou not laugh?
No, cause I rather weep.
Good heart, at what?
At thy good heart's oppression.
Why, such is love's transgressions. Griefs of mine own lie heavy in my breast, which thou wilt propagate, have it pressed with more of thine. This love that thou hast shown doth add more grief to too much of mine own. Love is a smoke made with the fume of sighs, being purged, a fire sparkling in lover's eyes, being vexed, a sea nourished with loving tears. What is it else? A madness most discreet, a choking gall, and a preserving sweet. Farewell, my cause.
Soft, I will go along, and if you leave me so, you do me wrong.
But I have lost myself, I am not here. This is not Romeo, he's some other where.
Tell me in sadness, who is that you love?
What, shall I groan and tell thee?
Groan? Why, no, but sadly tell me who.
Bid a sick man in sadness make his will. Ah, were it ill urged to one that is so ill. In sadness, cousin, I do love a woman.
I ain't so near when I suppose you love.
A right good marksman, and she's fair I love.
A right fair mark, fair cuz, the same as him.
Well, and that hit you miss shall not be hit with Cupid's arrow. She had Dian's wit, and in strong proof of chastity, well armed. From love's weak childish bow, she lives uncharmed. She will not say the siege of loving terms, nor bideth or bide the encounter of assailing eyes, nor ope her lap to saint seducing gold. Oh, she's rich in beauty, only poor, that when she dies with beauty, dies her store.
Then she has sworn that she would live, that she would still live chaste.
She hath, and in that sparing made huge waste, for beauty, starved with her severity, cuts beauty off from all prosperity. She is too fair, too wise, wisely too fair, to merit bliss by making me despair. She hath forsworn to love, and in that vow do I live dead, that live to tell it now.
Be ruled by me, forget to think of her.
Oh, teach me how I should forget to think.
On giving liberty into thine eyes, examine other beauties.
Tis the way to call hers exquisite, and question more. These happy masks that kiss fair ladies' brows, being black, puts us in mind that hide the fair. He that is struck and blind cannot forget the precious treasure of his eyesight lost. Show me a mistress that is passing fair. What doth her beauty serve but as a note, where I may read to pass that passing fair? Farewell, thou canst not teach me to forget.
I'll pay that doctrine, or else die in death.